You might think I am here to say animal foods are not good for you. I am not. If you are going hungry, any source of calories and nutrients is good for you. But if you have a choice, they are probably not optimal for you over the long term. And if you care about our modern challenges, they are not right for us as a community. All the meaty, low-carb, paleo-fad diets being peddled seem to me to be an unfortunate distraction from some basic and pressing facts. When you snap out of your paleo fantasy, there will be some inescapable realities you will probably eventually have to face along with the rest of us. The Harvard School of Public Health and the World Economic Forum have released their best assessment of the staggering burden of diabetes and other non-communicable diseases threatening our future finances. Over the next 2 decades, the world economy will be dealt a $47 trillion hit from these diseases. Most of these diseases are affected by nutrition to some extent, particularly heart disease and diabetes. According to the International Diabetes Federation, by the year 2030, 1 in 10 adults is expected to be diabetic. These non-communicable diseases won't just affect the richest nations. Developing countries will see more and more productive years in the lives of their people wasted due to these epidemics. This is not just a financial disaster, but a human tragedy. Central to this problem is the global epidemic of obesity. The Lancet has looked at this issue recently, and their findings are grim. Here you see trends in childhood obesity among selected industrialized nations. Clearly, we are failing our children, especially in the United States. Everyone in public health is aware of these discouraging trends. There is also broad agreement over why they are happening. People are more sedentary, yet food is more abundant. Some of the increases in non-communicable diseases are simply a result of longer lifespans. But trends in childhood diabetes and obesity, as you see here, are clearly a result of changing diets. What is so wrong with modern diets? How are they different now? This remarkable map is from 1941. Notice the legend to the left. The darkest regions here represent populations that obtained only 30-40% of their calories from cereals and potatoes. The more lightly shaded areas consume between 60-90% of their calories from these fantastic high-carb foods. This is how cereal and potato consumption broke down by population. Look at the heavy concentration of people in the 80-90% range. This is nearly 2/3 of the world population. Until very recently, the world ate very high-carb diets from mostly wholesome sources, and there was no obesity epidemic. The world collectively became richer since then, allowing people to afford to eat foods frequently that used to be eaten only occasionally. Here you can see it was understood back in 1969 that as incomes rise, so does the consumption of animal products. Along the left, the graph shows increasing gross national product. Along the bottom is the percentage of total calories a food group represents. The most obvious loser as wealth increases is in the white section in the middle, starchy carbohydrates. At the bottom of the wealth spectrum, they represent about 70% of calories. Other losers with wealth are vegetable proteins and vegetable fats. Those that increase with wealth are animal fats, processed fats, meats, and sugars. That's a disastrous combination for human health, and the trends have continued like this since then. This graph picks up where the last one left off in 1969. You were looking at the percentage of calories derived from cereals, separated by year and by the category of country, developing, industrialized, and transition. Developing countries ate the most cereals, but they are predicted to lower their consumption of them into the future. Industrialized countries ate the least, and that is not expected to change. Compare that to past and expected trends of meat and dairy consumption. Compare the second line from the top, the developing countries, to the second line from the bottom, industrialized countries. In particular, compare the value for meat in developing countries in 1964 through 1966 with the value for meat in industrialized countries anticipated for 2030. That's nearly a tenfold difference. Here's a visual for these trends in meat consumption starting in 1995. You can see world meat consumption is increasing far faster than world population. Here's how meat consumption currently varies now by region. The developed world and North America are along the bottom. It's hard to believe these regions are actually expected to dramatically increase their meat consumption from these already gluttonous levels. Many self-styled diet experts want you to believe wheat consumption is the problem, but wheat is eaten far less now than in the past. This decline was noted all the way back in 1929. There is no question that meat is eaten more now, though. We've gotten so extreme, we are starting to see ads on TV for gout. This guy is carrying around a symbolic bottle of uric acid. Gout used to be associated with the rich. Now enough people have it that it pays to advertise drugs for it on television. Gout, of course, is associated with higher red meat consumption. Are you such an amazingly well-adapted paleo meat eater that you can never experience gout? I doubt it, considering that even Tyrannosaurus Rex suffered from it, thanks to its meaty, purine-rich diet. Meanwhile, we're eating far fewer fruits and vegetables than we need. The result for us Americans is a chart that looks like this. Joel Fuhrman has categorized our food consumption the right way to show how low our standards have become. By far, the biggest share of calories is now taken up by unhealthy processed foods, followed by animal products. Unrefined plant foods and whole grains, the pillars of good health, combine to total only 12.5%. This leaves out the changing nature of the meat we eat. I find this table to be remarkable. Here you see the nutritional characteristics of broiler chickens dating back all the way to 1870. These birds have progressively been bred and raised to deliver dramatically more fat and calories. The chickens people eat now are nothing like they used to be. As I showed you in the previous section, China is caught up in this global nutrition transition. The world's most populous country is now consuming more protein and much more fat as a percentage of total calories. These changes between 1989 and 2004 are modest compared to what we expect to see. Rice consumption has remained flat. And as you know by now, wheat consumption there will decline. But all major categories of animal foods are expected to skyrocket. The price for this is their health. Look how steep these trend lines have been for diabetes and glucose intolerance. Obesity and metabolic syndrome are dramatically rising as well. There is a country that is an even more dramatic example of the nutrition transition than China, though. I'll tell you about it in part 2.